Mallikarjuna. Mallika, jasmine. Arjuna is the hero. Arjati iti Arjuna in Sanskrit, one who conquers. So her poems represent the softness of jasmine, and they also have a lot of masculine force, as we'll discover as we read along. So it's the combination of feminine softness and masculine hardness that's indicated with the Ankita, the signature. So it's a almost like a proper noun. So if we start translating this, as I said, we should then translate Ramanujan's name as younger brother of the handsome one. Rama, handsome one. Anuja, younger brother of the handsome one. Okay, now we read on. She has more than 300 vachanas and nearly 60% of them have great poetic value. The clear light of the sun, the sky's expanse, the movement of the breeze, the leaves, flowers, trees, bushes, and creepers, seven colors. These, the splendors of the day, the glow of the moon, stars, lightning, and so on, all things glowing, your worship at night. Day and night, I lose myself in your worship. Oh, Chandamalikarjuna. And the next poem deals with one of the themes that we are looking at in these texts when we are trying to discover the models of mind which are at work. How does Akka Mahadevi look at sexuality? And this question of sexuality becomes foregrounded in the next text, Shunya Sampadna text that we are going to read later. Look at this. And we have seen how Jainas deal with sexuality. They go through it till they reach the saturation point. And then they go in the opposite direction. Here is a different approach. If you can pull out the serpent's fangs and make it dance, it's good to make friends with serpents. If you can describe the body's composition, it's good to make friends with the body. Like a mother turned into a she monster, body sickness. Oh, Chandamallikarjuna, don't say those you love have a body. Our next poem is significant. Akka Mahadevi, for the first time, brings a woman's perspective into spirituality. In a lot of so-called bhakti literature and yogic literature, Maya is always treated as a woman. Akka Mahadevi questions this. She says, Yogige Yogini Yagi Karitubaye. Yoginige Yogi Yagi Karitubaye. Maya haunted Yogi in the form of Yogini and Yogini in the form of Yogi. Samaranga Samani Yagi Karitubaye. Samaranga Samana Nagi Karitubaye. Maya haunted Samana. As a Samani, female nun. And the nun as a monk. So Maya can be both masculine gender and feminine gender. In the next poem, Maya is seen as a man, as a he. Ooh! This empty show of the world. First he comes, the masked one, saying, Oh Father, Papa, Next comes a mustache masked one daubed with ghee. At the end comes a mask of old age. The moment your eyesight ceases, the dance of the world stops. O Chandamani Kanchan. It's a radical departure from how devotional and yogic imagination treats Maya. Next, it's a famous poem which Rama has also translated. To him with no death, no decay, no form, to the beautiful one, I've given myself, O Mother. To him with no place, no end, no space, no signs, to the beautiful one, I've given myself, O Mother. To him with no clan, no country, to the peerless, handsome one, I've given myself up, O Mother. For this reason, Chandamallikarjuna, the handsome one, is the man for me. These wasting, dying men, take them away, throw them into the oven. The last one. This again is a show depicts how she deals with vasanas. Should compare it to the way giants deal with it. You hunger. Stand still. Stand still. You thirst. Stand still. Stand still. You delusion. Stand still. Stand still. You lust. Stand still. Stand still. You intoxication. Stand still, stand still. You pride, you hate. Stand still, stand still. All of you, still and moving. Stand still, stand still. I'm carrying an urgent letter to my master, Chandamallikarjuna. Goodbye.
How does that sound in Kannada?
Hasive ninu nillu nillu. ತೃಷಯೆ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಮೋಹವೇ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಕಾಮವೇ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಮದವೇ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಅಹಂಕಾರವೇ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಹಗೆಯೇ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಚರಾಚರವೇ ನೀನು ನಿಲ್ಲು ನಿಲ್ಲು ಎನ್ನೊಡೆಯ ಚನ್ನಮಲ್ಲಿಕಾರ್ಜುನಂಗೆ ಅವಸರದ ಓಲೆಯನ್ನು ಇಯುತ್ತಿದ್ದೇನೆ ಶರಣು ಶರಣಾರ್ಥಿ. So now, I want you to take a look at them by yourselves and then discuss the model of mind which is at work in these vachanas, which is different from the model of mind which is at work in the artist's poems that we took a look at yesterday. It's not the... Sit next to Rustam or Shamigda. I think quite a few new elements have entered into the imaginative world in these poems. What do you think is the new element in the first poem? If you like to know? Devotion as?
As an emptiness.
No, that's okay, but where does she see it? Does she see it in the temple?
No.
Or in the symbol?
In nature.
In nature. In Sangam poetics, Tirunai, nature, stood for different aspects of love relationship, human love. But in Tamil bhakti poetry, of the three grades, Mudal Mover, Upper Sundarar, and Sambandar, nature enters poetry in a big way, but they describe the surroundings of the temple they go to. So nature has a kind of metonymic relationship with the object of devotion. Sometimes in stray moments, nature itself becomes deified. For example, there is a poem by Upper. They can't quote it in the original. He once goes to the famous temple of Shiva in Aluve, present-day Kerala. Doesn't find Shiva there. But he goes into the forest and he sees a male and female elephant mating. He has a vision of Shiva in that forest. So this deification of nature, this note, is very strong in a Kannada. And some of our vachanas have very interesting intertextuality with the fifth act of Kalidasa's Vikram Urvashiya. When Urvashi disappears, she becomes a creeper. And Pururava, like a madman, goes in search of her. It's intense human love. He talks to peacocks, birds, trees. He asks them, where is my beloved? And this text, for some reason, appears to have gone into a lot of bhakti poetry all down the ages, in the 20th century. But though the lines are similar, it has got another level of signification. Human love, in the earlier practice, human nature was a metaphor for human love. In later bhakti poetic practice, human love becomes a metaphor for divine love. And nature itself becomes deified. And Tagore's Gitanjali is the last fruit of this vision. People who read Tagore only in English translation, most of them said, oh, he's a silly romantic. Is copied from Shelley and Wordsworth and so on. But this has not come from Shelley or Wordsworth, something that has come from within the tradition, through Bhakti and Baul, Gita Govindam and so on. So this is an important note, where devotion, in a way, if I can put it that way, has become secularized. Nature embodies the divine. And also, the way nature is invoked. In Marga Kavya, among Ashtadasha Varnanas, 18 descriptions, it's compulsory to have description of nature. But the nature that figures there is most often kavisa, full of kavisamaya. It's not based on observation, except in great poets like Pampa. It's the stock in trade of poetic vocabulary. For example, many of these poets talk about oceans with lotuses because they've never seen an ocean in their lives. And the cliches like every tree is a kalpavriksha and every cow, every animal in the forest is like something else, some kamadeno and things like that. But here, this is a direct observation of nature because the place which Akamahadevi came from, Udupari, to my mind, has one of the best landscapes in India. And she was a great observer of nature. And in the second poem, it's negotiating sexuality. Notice there's a slight inversion of metaphor. Serpent is the metaphor in yogic literature for Kundalini. And this metaphor of playing with the snake is developed in many spiritual poems, particularly in the Siddha tradition of Tamil. There's a famous song by Pattinathar, 17th century. It's called Pambu Pattu, the song of the serpent. And I said in Jainism, the model of the mind is from world conquest. By world is meant political power, sexual power, aesthetic power, to self-conquest. Here, when you move towards self-conquest, you have to leave behind the world. Here, so which means you have to leave behind sexuality. And this freedom from sexuality is symbolically acted out in the ritual of removing every hair from the head manually, one by one. Because the initiate has to bear with this pain to qualify for initiation. Chula Kriya. So here, no need to torture the body. It's good to make friends with the body. If you remove the snake's fang, you can play with it. Remove that fang from the body, it's good to make friends with the body. So when you become a real yogi or a bhakta, the body doesn't bother you. So this is self-transformation. Elsewhere, the same thing is indicated through the metaphor of alchemy. how the base metal is transformed into gold. Next one is interesting because it challenges the gender of Maya. By the way, Maya in Shaivite poetry has a different connotation than in Shankaradvaita. It does not mean illusion. It means contracted vision. So there is no question of the unreality of the world. And the next one typifies a whole tradition of bhakti poets like Meera, Laleshwari, and so on, who see the Ishta Devata as the beloved. The next one also, it talks to so-called temptations playfully. So when I'm doing this, when I'm involved in bhakti, taking an urgent letter to my Lord, don't bother me. I'm not fighting with you. Just stay where you are. Mind your business. Let me do my business. So this is the changed approach to sensuality and physicality that has come about in a Kannada research. And also, if you go back to artisan poets, none of them talk about the traps of temptations. They don't complain about lust. They don't complain about anything. It's there. It doesn't bother them. They focus their mind on their labor as an act of spirituality. Now, we come to Basavarna, who, according to most people, is the central figure in Sharana movement. And it's an interpretation which is now being questioned by many contemporary interpreters. Dalit scholars have questioned this centrality. And I did this in my play on Basavarna, for which I paid a very heavy price for several years. But it's important. Because he was able to, he became a rallying point for these different strands which came together at this moment. And he's a great poet. And he's a past master in similes. Yama Srinivasamurti compared Basavarna to Kalidasa. He said, Upama Kalidasasya. He says in Kannada, it's not any classical poet, it's Basavarna has the same mastery over similes. And in Basavarna's poetry, you have all these strands coming together. You have the strand of fanatical devotion. And you have a strong content of satire. And more than anything else, there is a very intense confessional mode. He lives the dialectics between the opposites. And always laid his heart bare without hiding anything. Somewhat like the way Gandhi often did when he embarrassed his own followers. by speaking the truth about yourself. So now we go through this Vachanas, then we'll talk about it. The elephant is huge. Can you say the driver's hook is small? No, Father, you cannot. The mountain is huge. Can you say the lightning bolt is small? No, Father, you cannot. Darkness is immense. Can you say the lamp is small? No, Father, you cannot. Forgetfulness is immense. Can you say the heart that remembers you is small? No, Father, you cannot. Kari ghana, ankusha kiridanna bahude, baradaiya. Giri ghana, pulisha kiridanna bahude, baradaiya. Tamandha ghana, jyoti kiridanna bahude, baradaiya. Marahu ghana, nimma neneva mana, kiridanna bahude, baradaiya. Next one, Prof. An example of his confessional mode. The swollen wave of the ocean of the world is a swollen wave of the ocean of the world playing about my face. Tell me, has the ocean of the world risen to my chest? Tell me, has the ocean of the world risen to my throat? Tell me, what can I say when the ocean of the world is rising over my head? Oh, oh, hear me howl. Oh, 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 Father, oh, Father, Kudala Sangama, what can I do? So, intense dramatization of the moment. Before the bearded chin turns gray, and the cheeks wrinkle, the body turns into a cage. Before the teeth fall away, the back is bent, and you are dependent on others. Before one hand rests on your knee, and another holds a stick. Before age disfigures the frame, before death touches you, worship him, our master. Now, there's also this element of bridal mistress song, which we find in Akamadevi. And bridal mysticism is characteristic not only of woman bhaktas, but male bhaktas also. I've caged the bird, oiled the lamb, got the wick ready, and waiting for his coming, O mother. When dry leaves rustle, I look out listening. My abandoned heart begins to rage, O mother. When devotees of Kudal Sangamadeva stand at the door saying Shiva, how happy I become, O mother. Next appears to be a comment on our situation now. Yes, you can stand around when the oven is burning, but where can you flee when the whole earth is burning? When the band and the fence grazes the field, and the housewife steals from her own house, and the mother's poisoned breast milk kills, O Kudala Sadeva, to whom shall I complain? Listen, you man, listen. Only for your sake I wear a man's garb. Once again, I'm a man. Once again, I'm a woman. O Kudala Sadeva, the confluence. I am a man hero for you and a bride for your devotees. Next one, is an unusual poem, which is similar to one of those cryptic Belugu poems. They trap the hill, O brother, and stretch before me the net of sins. The hunter came, chasing the beast. The beast now inside the tomb. The beast caught in the net of Hara became a dish for a Kurila Sangamadeva. So now, please read it on your own for a few minutes and to discuss what are the new elements that are coming to the magic world. Okay, get back to this. So, what do you think are the new elements that we find here?
Sensation. Something like where the sensation is so real. I think the second point.
The third important point. All the Vachana, even in the Kamadeva's Vachana. When she talks about nature, it's lived experience. It's not the report of what other people have seen. This immediacy of experience, a new kind of intimacy, immediacy, comes into the language. Something that was called in the context of modern literature, authenticity. Authenticity of experience.
I'm curious, in the second poem, the nine, this last line, what the nine is, W-H-H-H-H. How does that fit with?
In Kannada, it says, Enevena, Enevena, in Kannada. So I wanted to replicate that onomatopoeia, he said. And this was the strategy that I followed. I thought that would work. Like Hopkins does sometimes, where was the place? Yes, sir.
Intensely aware of both the reality. The reality which is the regular reality which is shared by everybody else. And whatever reality they're living, they're aware of both. And they're like kind of the guests in the regular reality and go back.
You elaborate what's interesting. What is regular? How do you mean by regular reality?
It's like we are asking that, like, tell me the second one. Oh. Asking.
Yeah. Yeah, you're saying something very important. Just elaborate. You're nearly there, saying something very important. Do you mean this, that it has the tone of somebody talking to somebody directly? The directness of the expression. This is what Anubhaava said, Vastuka Varnaka. It's there. But this is here and now. Sometimes they talk to God. Be pleased if you like. Nino Idara Vali, Vali Idara Manu. Don't if you don't. I can't help singing now. Ninna harder than Amani. They're talking to the representatives of other samayas, other worldviews. Veda Purusharira, Nimma Veda Vedisarade Kettudalla. You follow the Veda. Your Vedas came to grief because they couldn't understand anything. Shastra Purusharira, Nimma Shastra Sadhisarade Kettudalla. You, the followers of Shastras, your Shastras came to grief because they couldn't demonstrate anything. Agama Purusharira, Nimma Agama Ariyalarade Kettudalla. You followers of Agamas, your Agamas came to grief because they could not be aware of anything. So, talking to people, talking to nature, Ede Sankulave, O foliages, Mamarave, mango tree, Veladingare, O moonlight, Kogilaye, O coil bird. So it's direct speech. Bhaktin said that literary tradition consists of indirect speech. It's true of the Marga traditions, sometimes of the folk traditions. But in Anubhaava traditions. Now, I don't want to describe this as, these are examples of bhakti tradition, of Anubhaava tradition, where bhakti is one of the streams. They talk directly to God, to the deity, human beings, and objects around us. It's a dialogic relationship. And when Ramanujan translated these texts into English, one of the biggest flaws of his otherwise beautiful translation is that he sacrificed the dialogic force of the poems. Because his model of good English was the good English of Anglo-American poetry of the 60s, poetry of Philip Larkin, Tom Gunn, and so on, where language of poetry had turned monologic. So addresses are very important. For example, one of the words recurrently used in Vachanas is Ayya. It doesn't have the same meaning. Sometimes it means friend, sometimes it's master, sometimes lord, and so on. So, this address is a very important part of these texts. the dialogic text.
Is it more pronounced, you feel, in these poems rather than in the artisan? In the artisan poems, is there more similar?
In artisan poem also, there's address. In that Duraya the cobbler, when he challenges Shiva of years. ಉಡಿಯ ಮನೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರತ್ಯಕ್ಷನಾದ ಪರಮೇಶ್ವರನ ಕಂಡು ದೆನ್ ಇ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಹಿಮ್. ಇತ್ತಲೇಕೆ ಬಂದಿರಯ್ಯ, ವೈ ಡಿಡ್ ಯು ಕಮ್ ಹಿಯರ್? ನಿನ್ನ ಬೆಳಿಯ ಬೆಟ್ಟಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗು, ಗೋ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಟು ಯುವರ್ ಸಿಲ್ವರ್ ಮೌಂಟನ್. ನಿನ್ನ ಭಕ್ತರಿಂದ ಟಾವಿಲ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗು, ಗೋ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಟು ದ ಹಾಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುವರ್ ಡಿವೋಟೀಸ್. ನಿನ್ನ ನೀನೇ ಹರಿ, ಗೋ ಅಂಡ್ ರಿಯಲೈಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್. ನನ್ನದು ಕಾಮ ಧೂಮ ಧುರೇಶ್ವರನ ಪಥ, ಮೈ ಪಾತ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಪಾತ್ ಆಫ್ the lord of the dust and smoke. Lust, dust and smoke. It was dramatic. And the people who translated first before Ramanujan, they translated this into a kind of romantic poetry. They brought in all these thous and thines, biblical, nexus, and stock in trade of romantic poetry. So most of the English translations, including Ramanujan's, most of the times, sometimes Ramanujan breaks it. For example, there's a phrase called "aghatita ghatitanu." Ramanujan puts it, translates very beautifully, a happening that never happened. Except in such cases, he is trying to fit the verbal structure of the source text into the already established style of the target language. And what I've tried, don't know whether I've succeeded, is to inscribe the target language with the gestures of the source language, even while sometimes doing causing rupture in the target language.
Could you tell us something about how the personal pronoun I, how is that changing?
See, this is one problem in translations. In Kannada, the person is indicated mostly by the noun. By the verb. Most often, I is not mentioned. So, for example, in English I call is an I-centric language. I think it's not correct. I don't agree. But in Kannada, we never say, I think. It's a real answer. This is not right, it seems to me. This doesn't look to be right. Not, I don't think this is right. It doesn't look to be right. But of late, because the patterns of English are being imposed on Kannada. For example, there was no thank you in Kannada. There were other ways of expressing gratitude in all our Indian languages. So, Dhanyavad and in Kannada, Vandanegaru. Nandri in Tamil, Nanni in Malayalam. These are the literal translations of English, thank you. And there was no good morning, good evening in our language. So, Shubha Ratri, Shubha whatever. So, recently I was reading somewhere that somebody from Switzerland, a literary critic, had written that in European languages, what's now happening is that these languages are getting more and more anglicized, which have their own literary traditions. So, a new English style is emerging out of these languages. He says, in one sense, this can travel through translation to other languages, but we can no more have a James Joyce or a William Carlos Williams or a Baudelaire, who use the resources of the language. And in the history of our languages, this kind of superimposition of the master language happened two times. First, when Sanskrit model was imposed. And then in the 20th century, 19th and 20th century, when the English model was imposed. So the significance of Vachanasi is in that, in the context of an established literary tradition, an imitative literary tradition, which I call Tatsama and Tadbhava tradition, through the Vachanas, a new style, which is in continuation with tribal and folk idiom, is emerging. This was never the case in Tamil. In Tamil, there was a direct connection between the tribal folk expression and the classical text of Kapiya. And Tamil never went through the kind of Sanskritization that Kannada and Telugu and Malayalam went through. Kannada was the first to be Sanskritized, then Telugu, and Telugu poets were inspired from the Karnataka example. And Nannaya, when he wrote the Mahabharata in Telugu, the classical mood. But this was challenged by Palkuruke Somanathudu, the first biographer of Basavanna, who was inspired by the example of Vachanas. So he brought in the folk meter and everyday language of the people into poetry. In Malayalam, the literary language was, to the best of my knowledge, was completely Sanskritized. And in fact, Malayalam became an independent language much later than other South Indian languages. It was part of the Tamil, because Chera, Nadu, was part of Tamilaham in the ancient period. So when we talk about the models of South Indian mind, we can't sum it up through one story. We have different stories. Karnataka story, Tamil story, and Telugu story, and Malayalam story. Yeah.
I think one of the poems in the cut that you've given us, there's a line in which the lion and the elephant are together. And
which one?
First. Yeah, the 30th.
Which one? Who's Vachana?
Number 30.
Whose Vachana is it?
I think it's the Alamma.
Okay, we haven't started reading Alamma as yet. We'll come back to Alamma now. Now, what I want to do is, we'll read Alamma till time, and then we go out for tea. Then we discuss Alamma briefly, and then I want to focus on this very important Shunya Sampadne text. So I'll read Alamma now. And Alamma is as strange as his name, except very few people are named Alamma. A Prabhu, his second part of his name is Alamma Prabhu. In Virasheva community, there are people whose names are Deva, Prabhu, and so on. Never Alamma Prabhu. Except one man I know who is a very bad poet, by the way. And my uncle in Tamil Nadu, who is called Alamma Prabhu, who knows about Alamma Prabhu or poetry. He's a retired postmaster. So this is a name. And scholars have debated on the etymology of his name. Some people say it's the transform of Lama, because there was Vajrayana cult around his place. And, some people say he was a Sufi, Ulama becomes Alamma. All kinds of speculations, but we just don't know. And his mode is totally different. He's certainly not Bhakti. It is an intensely, in English I have to use the word mystical, which is unfortunate. In Kannada we have the, fortunately we have the word Anubhaava. Anubhaava way of looking at the world. And the bhaktas speak through metaphors. Allama speaks through paradoxes. So there is an intense tension in his poems. And his imagery does not come from observed nature. It comes from the archetypal world. Some works of literature look to nature for metaphors. Some look within. In English, the best example is Moby Dick. The world described in Moby Dick is not out there, but it's something internalized. So Allama uses a lot of archetypal images. And he does not make a statement most often, but he challenges all statements. And problematizes all statements. Okay. On the field without earth, a man without eyes found diamonds. Another without hands strung them together. Another without the neck wore it. O Gogeshwara. This Ankita, Ramanujan's translation is Lord of the Caves, Guheshwara. Because he depended on certain textual variants who retained this Ankita. But the history of the manuscripts of Vachana shows that originally it was Gogeshwara. Gogaya means a muni, a yogi in the villages, is called Gogaya. And in Allama's birthplace, there is still a place called Gogayana Tota, the garden of Gogaya, where he is supposed to have attained enlightenment. So when this manuscript, it was written in the early manuscript, Gogeshwara, because it was very difficult to write this consonantal conjunction Kannada, somebody, a later copyist, made Gogeshwara. Then somebody made it Goheshwara, because Ha is easier to write when you're writing like this than Ga. And then somebody, some purist came and said, no, this is bad language, bad Kannada. So let me translate, he made it Goheshwara. And so we have Ramanujan's translation, Lord of Caves. But even that's the wrong translation. Guha is not cave. Guha is space within and without. But this is not at all what is there in the earliest manuscripts of the Vachanas. So I have retained the word Gogeshwara. From Baldigave.
Ah.
When cinders rain down, be like the water.
You didn't finish earlier.
Oh, Gogeshwara. Is there ever ruin to beauty lacking the body? When cinders rain down, be like the water. When in the water deluge, be like the wind. When in the great deluge, be like the sky. When in the cosmic deluge, give yourself up and become Gogeshwara himself. The earth and the sky are stomach in a living thing. Tell me, what is great here to him that does not call it great? Tell me, what is trivial here to him that does not call it trivial? If greatness enters the heart, is there anything like it, O Gogeshwara? In the infinite dark, who placed the inordinate light, its opposite? Darkness is, light is itself the same. There, what kind of marvel is this? One is not afraid of the other. Seeing the elephant and the lion together feeding, I was amazed, O Gogeshwara. That is Ramananda's translated. While stepping back to watch your splendor, Ramananda's translated, when I went out looking for your light, because the original word in the source text is Nimma Tejava Herasari Noduttiralo. Herasari is an old word, 12th century word, which means Herasari means when you look at something frightening, you step back. But Ramanujan thought it's a printing mistake. Horasari went out, so it translated went out. While stepping back to watch your splendor, it was like 100 billion suns rising, O Father. It was like cutting through the maze of lightning creepers, lifting up the root, looking at it, O Father. O Gogeshwara, if you become a linga of flame, no one can compare and see. The word Virgil says, Guheshwara, neenu jyotirlinga vadare, yenanu upamisuvenayya. Ramanujan has translated, where can I find metaphors? It's not metaphors, it's similes. There's a very important difference between metaphors and similes. In the ice forest, in the midst of the town, five corpses are lying. They keep coming, weeping, the kinsmen, because there are so many, so great. The firewood will not be put out, neither will the corpse burn up. Only the buyer is in flame, O Gogeshwara. So, these are Allama Prabhu's poems. Now we come back to them after the tea break. Thank you.